back here at Toledo with my old friend, Professor Strang. I spoke here about 4 years ago. It was a wonderful event. And it's actually here in Toledo that I put on the very first academic conference that I ever organized. It was back in the spring of 1998 in downtown Toledo, a wonderful event having to do with what was then Ohio's brand new experiment with school choice programs. So for me, coming back here is a real treat. I'm aware that I am kind of standing in the way for some of you between you and pizza, and I'm very sensitive to that. I know I'm a poor substitute for pizza, so you should feel free to enjoy it while I'm talking. Just don't throw it at me. Religious freedom questions are always of interest, but they seem particularly pressing today. Now, I was asked a year or so ago to serve as a consultant to the Catholic Bishop's new Committee on Religious Liberty by then Archbishop Timothy Dolan. And in their recent statement, which is called Our First Most Cherished Liberty, the members of that committee expressed gratitude for the, quote, gift of liberty which is ours as Americans, but they also noted the need to remain on guard and to take care of that gift. One such challenge, they observed, is a policy that I'm sure most of you are familiar with, the so-called HHS mandate, which is a federal rule that requires most religious employers to provide coverage for certain preventative services, including FDA-approved contraceptives, and also, more controversially, some abortion-causing drugs. Now, as many of you know, my boss, the president of the University of Notre Dame, announced last summer that, quote, neither lightly nor gladly, the university had filed a lawsuit seeking to vindicate its institutional religious liberty and challenging the legality of this rule. The university's argument, in brief, is that the mandate requires Notre Dame and also other Catholic institutions, healthcare institutions, schools, social welfare agencies, and so on, to act inconsistently with their mission, with their character. And so far, as you might know, courts have divided in these cases. Administrative processes are continuing. It appears the administration might revise the rule, and so we'll see. In any event, I raise this issue just to underscore what I imagine you all know, which is that we live in interesting times. So here, in a nutshell, are my thoughts about our topic today. As I see it, religious freedom is a human right, grounded in human dignity and essential for human flourishing. Every person, because he or she is a person, has the right to religious liberty, and that right has to include the right to be wrong, the right to reject religion. This right and this freedom should be recognized, respected, protected, and promoted in law and policy. It's true that religious freedom is sometimes inconvenient for governments. It's sometimes inconvenient for politicians. But I believe it's crucially important to good government and to stable politics. What's more, as I see it, this freedom should be understood, and I'll explain what I mean by these terms in a bit, but this freedom should be understood not merely as freedom from religion, and not only as freedom of religion, but also, I'll suggest, as freedom for religion. Now, to say all this, and I can't emphasize this enough, is not to deny that political authority and the government's laws should be secular. In my view, they should be. To say this instead is to endorse what the Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI has repeatedly called, with admiration, America's healthy secularity. This is an arrangement that distinguishes between church and state precisely in order to protect religious freedom in private, in public, in civil society, and in politics. So in my view, the bishops were right to celebrate our long American tradition of using the rule of law to protect religious liberty. And they were also right, they are also right, I think, to be concerned. What former Notre Dame law professor and judge of the Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit, John Noonan, called the, quote, American experiment in religious liberty is, I will suggest, both vital and vulnerable. Our religious freedom protections here in the United States are robust, but they're incomplete. Our church-state arrangement, in my view, is exemplary, but it's also sometimes confused. We have to remember that the Constitution is a great achievement in ordered liberty, but as others have pointed out, it's just another elegant scrap of paper unless we keep it alive with our convictions. So we can and we should be proud of and grateful for our legal arrangements, but at the same time, we can and should be clear-eyed about the challenges we face. So our topic today involves questions and commitments that matter. They're important to me as a lawyer and a teacher and a scholar. They're also important to me, and I imagine they're important to a lot of you, as a citizen. The topic is timely and also timeless. And while it's always risky, especially with an expert constitutional historian like Lee Strang in the room, to make confident statements about our founding, I think it is safe to say that we Americans have been wrestling with today's question from our beginnings. Thomas Jefferson regarded the religious freedom guarantees that were enacted after our revolution as a, quote, fair and novel experiment. And it was the confident hope of James Madison that this experiment, quote, promised a luster to our country. Madison believed that a specifically American approach to religious freedom was emerging, and he thought, he hoped, that it would distinguish and shape and strengthen us. He and many other leaders of the founding generation seemed to have been keenly aware that they were attempting something new, something that could change the world. Indeed, Madison once confessed that, quote, it is impossible for the man of pious reflection not to perceive in the formation of our Constitution a finger of the Almighty hand. So they weren't falsely modest, but the founders were appropriately aware of the weight of their responsibility. Adams, John Adams, revealed as much when he wrote that, quote, the people in America have now the best opportunity and the greatest trust in their hands that Providence has ever committed to so small a number. If we betray that trust, our guilt will merit the indignation of heaven. So we should ask, what have we, the people of America, made of what Adams called our best opportunity? Professor John Witte, who's one of the leading scholars of religious liberty law in America, has reported that, quote, the bold constitutional experiment in granting religious liberty to all remains in place and remains in progress in the United States. And it does. But how goes that progress? Have we betrayed our trust? Or, as Madison hoped, and as the Pope Emeritus seems to have believed, have our efforts actually added luster to our country? So again, the American experiment in religious liberty is both vital and vulnerable. I want to suggest to you that we should be proud, but also vigilant. So I'll try during our time together to explain what I mean by all this, but first I hope you'll forgive me if I sound something of a personal note here. As you heard, I teach and I write at Notre Dame down the interstate. And there, my colleagues and I invite, and I hope occasionally we inspire our students to bring their commitments and their hopes with them to their studies, and also to carry them back out in good repair, perhaps better understood, to their lives in the law. In our view, we can't expect young lawyers to think deeply and well about service and justice and the common good if we tell them the whole time we're teaching them that they should privatize their ideals or radically separate their thoughts about the meaning of life from what they're learning about the practice of law. And so we urge students, at least we try to approach their vocations, and lawyering should be a vocation, as whole persons. I give them a speech about this when they show up, and I try to impose it on them again when they graduate. We challenge them to integrate what they do with what they profess and with what they claim to cherish. We ask them often to remember who they are and what they believe and where they came from. And I try to urge my students to resist the temptation to, quote, check their faith at the door of their professional and public lives. Well, with respect to our topic today, that is religious liberty in America, I start from a proposition that's a lot like the challenge I issue my students. As I see it, we, all of us, are entirely free, and I think our laws should protect this freedom, to participate in public life, to participate in the vocation of citizenship, to contend and cooperate with our neighbors in securing the common good. We're entitled to do all that as whole, integrated persons. So the philosopher was right, I think. We are political animals, but we're also, many of us believe, creatures made in the image and likeness of God. We're also, many of us believe, hardwired, in a way, to search for and cling to the one who made, sustains, and loves us. So the claim is it could be part of our nature, part of what it means to be human, to be both political and religious. And nothing in the text, history, or structure of the Constitution requires us to deny this. Nothing in our traditions requires us to accept disintegration as the price of admission to the practice of citizenship. Now, to be sure, again, we wisely separate the institutions and authority of religion from those of government. But the key is we do this not so much by building a wall between public and private or between religion and public life. We do this by respecting the genuine autonomy of these different spheres. And we do this not to cage and confine religion, but precisely in order to protect religious freedom, which includes, again, the freedom to live a faithful, integrated, balanced public life. Now, that's all very abstract, and the balance I'm talking about is not struck in the abstract, it's struck in the context of real-world disputes. And such disputes are not in short supply in America today, if you read the papers or the blogs. They're everywhere, and they're unavoidable, and not just because we just finished an election year. Most of us are familiar with the ongoing lawsuits and arguments about the HHS mandate, which I just mentioned, but this controversy is just one among many. For example, should the Pledge of Allegiance be recited by school children include the words "under God"? Should we permit religious holiday displays in front of government buildings, or depictions of the Ten Commandments on courthouse walls, or war memorial crosses in the wilds of the Mojave Desert, or on Mount Soledad in San Diego? Should we exempt religiously motivated drug use from the scope of our narcotics laws, or should we exempt church renovation projects from historical preservation rules? Should a lawyer in a murder trial appeal to jurors' religiously grounded opposition to the death penalty, or perhaps to their religiously grounded support for it? Should a legislator's belief that all life is sacred affect her votes on funding for embryo-destructive research? Or should a voter's Christian commitment to the preferential option for the poor shape her views on a proposed minimum wage increase? As the Supreme Court is considering this very day, does the fact that many Mormons supported California's Proposition 8 mean that the measure is unconstitutional? Should public officials invoke God in public or open official events with prayer? Should children in poor schools, from poor families, be allowed to use public scholarship funds to attend the parochial school? May a judge ever review the decision of a bishop to close a parish, or may a judge order a bankrupt diocese to close a homeless shelter, or award church property to a breakaway congregation, and so on? Engaging questions like these requires us to dig down a bit and to identify the foundations and the contents and the limits of the freedom of religion that is rooted in human dignity, that is celebrated in our traditions, and that is protected by our Constitution. So how should we go about this task? Well, President Clinton once said that religious freedom is, quote, literally our first freedom. His point, to be clear, was not simply that religious liberty happens to come first in what we now have as the Bill of Rights. His point, instead, was that the freedom of religion was central to the founders' vision for our new political community. For the founders, the freedom of religion was not only an object of their protection, something they were looking out for. They also thought of it as a crucial prerequisite for the success of this new political enterprise. To say this is not to say or to claim that America was or is or should be a, quote, Christian nation. It's just to observe that our Constitution was not designed to displace or defeat religion or to replace faith with state worship. Its aim instead was to build a stable and enduring political community that would be stronger precisely because it recognized that religious freedom is foundational. So the founders put religious liberty at the heart of this new project. Now, what this liberty meant in practice had to be worked out. And from the very outset, John Adams foresaw what he called a, quote, glorious uncertainty in the law of religious liberty. I'm pretty sure my students don't find this uncertainty so glorious when I'm trying to teach it to them. But he foresaw a glorious uncertainty and a noble diversity of understandings in its details. And history's obviously confirmed this prediction. The early Americans, like Americans today, didn't always agree about what precisely the freedom of religion means. They didn't agree about precisely how it should be protected in law. But they knew, as I think we still do, that religious freedom matters. And they knew that unless our most sacred things are protected, then our other freedoms, our freedoms of press and speech and privacy and conscience, are vulnerable. Religious freedom was seen then as part of the structure of a free society, and not merely as a grudging concession made by a generous sovereign. So it should be emphasized that the religious freedom protections afforded through our text, our constitutional text, and in our constitutional traditions, these aren't accidents. They're not anachronisms. They're not aberrations in our current progressive secular state. Quite the contrary. I believe that ours is a positive secularism. And so in our traditions, religious freedom is cherished and protected by the secular authorities as a basic human right, as an aspect of human dignity. Our Constitution, at its best, our Constitution properly understood, does not regard religious faith with grudging suspicion as a bizarre quirk or a quaint relic left over from our simpler past. The purpose of the First Amendment is not to push religion to the margins in the hope that it will gradually wither away. Instead, it's to safeguard and support it so that it can flourish. As my former colleague John Garvey liked to put it, our laws protect the freedom of religion because, put simply, religion is important and our laws think the freedom of religion is a good thing. So what is this healthy secularism that I've been mentioning? What does it look like? What are its features? Ideally, under healthy secularity, the freedom of religion is seen, as I've said, as a fundamental right which can coexist with the political community's obligation to promote and secure the public order. It's not a recipe for chaos. The political authority does not purport to exclude religious believers and values from public life or to exclude them from civic conversation. Instead, the idea is to protect everyone, believers and non-believers alike, against coercion in religious matters. A healthy secularity leaves to the voluntary and other associations of civil society, like churches and families and bowling leagues and all this, it leaves to them the responsibility of religious education and evangelization. But it protects the right of these associations to carry out that task. The right to public religion is honored just like the freedom of private religion is honored. And of course, both of these include the liberty to reject religion. In this vision, church and state are separate, not in the sense that faith is eliminated from public life, that would be impossible, but in a healthy sense, in that the institutions and authorities of government are separated from and prevented from interfering with the proper independence of the institutions and authorities of religion, which includes the authority of the individual religious conscience. Religious organizations and political officials can and do cooperate in some areas in promoting the common good, but governments do not presume to make or second-guess religious decisions. This healthy secularity model is secular in the sense that laws and policies are not supplied by religious authority, but again, it's healthy or positive in the sense that the understanding of human flourishing, of what it means to have a flourishing, healthy, good life, that the law is trying to promote, it includes the possibility of the search for religious truth. Now, all of this, I think, describes the American model, it describes this idea of healthy secularity at its best. Certainly, it's not the case that American courts and legislators and officials always act in accord with this model. Nobody's perfect. And it's easy to find stories in the media, in the law books, maybe in our own lives, involving public officials who've got things wrong, who've neglected our founding experiment's fundamental premises, maybe even turned them upside down. Well, why does this happen? What are the challenges to America's model of positive or healthy secularity? Why does the view persist, not only among rogue regulators, but also among commentators and scholars and judges and many of our fellow citizens? Why does the view persist that our Constitution requires somehow the exclusion or the muting or the silencing of religious voices and arguments from the public square? Why do some believe that religious liberty stops on Monday or stops at the church door? I don't believe the answer is a simple one of just blaming prejudice or anti-religious hostility. I think instead that this mistaken view reflects two misunderstandings of our Constitution, our history, and our traditions. And it's these misunderstandings that I think are the most pressing challenges to religious liberty in America today. Here's the first. Many of us forget that there is an intermediate social realm that exists, in a sense, between the purely private and the purely public. Between the personal sphere, house and home and hearth, and the government sphere is a whole lot in the middle. The large, busy, boisterous, crucially important space of civil society. This is where most of us spend most of our time. This is where we live. And almost everybody agrees that religion is protected in the purely private realm, perhaps in the purely private realm of your mind. And I think most people in America believe that the government's laws and the government's activities should remain secular. But what I think we sometimes forget, and again, this accounts, in my view, for some of the confusion, is that a healthy secularism can and should tolerate and welcome religion in that middle sphere, in the public, in civil society, at work and at play, as well as at prayer or in church. So as the bishops put it recently in the statement I mentioned before, quote, religious liberty is not only about the ability to go to Mass on Sunday or pray your rosary at home, it's about whether we can make our contribution to the common good of all Americans. The First Amendment, as all the students in the room know, limits government conduct. It says what government may not do. It says Congress shall make no law. It has nothing to say about private action, other than to confirm that religious expression and exercise and worship are worth protecting. So citizens, you and I, we can't violate the First Amendment when we engage in public discourse with our neighbors, when we engage in political activity with our fellow citizens. That's a protected activity. But officials and courts can violate the First Amendment if they attempt to exclude religious voices or to silence religious arguments. So the First Amendment's Establishment Clause is not the government's sword driving religious expression from the marketplace of ideas. Instead, the clause constrains government. It serves as a shield which protects religiously motivated speech and action. And so the question is not whether the First Amendment is violated when religious believers enter public life. The question is whether the First Amendment is violated when they're excluded. The Constitution doesn't demand what the late Father Richard Newhouse famously called the naked public square. The Constitution doesn't impose a don't ask, don't tell rule on religious believers who participate in public life. If a member of the Sierra Club or a member of the AARP can bring her values into civic life, then so can a member of the United Methodist Church. Of course, and this is important, there are plenty of reasons for reasonable believers to decide that not every political argument should be a religious one. I do believe that religious leaders have an obligation to teach and bear witness to the truth, even when that's uncomfortable. But it's also true, and we should remember, there are many questions about which reasonable and faithful religious believers disagree. It compromises the faith if we water it down to avoid giving offense, but it can also disrespect religion if we offer hasty or clunky baptisms of our favorite policy proposals. William James once quipped that in this age of toleration, no one will ever try to actively interfere with our religious life, provided we enjoy it quietly with our friends and don't make a nuisance of ourselves. Lots of strange things can be tolerated if they're private. But sometimes religious people are called precisely to make a public nuisance. And there's no reason for people who embrace democracy and pluralism to insist that religious citizens should act as though their faith was irrelevant. To be sure, the Constitution protects our right to keep our faith private, but it doesn't require us to privatize our faith or to disintegrate our lives before taking up the responsibilities of citizenship. That's the first challenge, that misunderstanding. The second has to do with an idea we've probably heard of our entire life, an idea that I've been thinking and writing about for a while now. And that's the idea of the separation of church and state. What does this idea mean, really? What does it have to do with our Constitution? Well, step back with me, those of you who are old enough to remember, to the kindler, gentler days of the 1988 campaign. Out on the campaign trail, then Vice President George H.W. Bush was recalling his experience as a young pilot in World War II. He'd been shot down over the South Pacific. And here's what he said, and again, those of you of a certain age might imagine Dana Carvey's voice from Saturday Night Live as I'm reading this. He said, was I scared floating in a little yellow raft off the coast of an enemy-held island, setting the world record for paddling? Of course I was. And what sustains you in times like that? You go back to fundamental values. I thought about mother and dad and the strength I got from them. I thought about God and faith and the separation of church and state. Now, this train of thought probably strikes us as absurd, and yet it's entirely American, right? That God and faith couldn't be invoked by the would-be president without this awkward addition speaks volumes about how we think about the First Amendment and about our first freedom. And of course, almost 200 years earlier, another president, Thomas Jefferson, had famously professed his, quote, sovereign reverence for what he saw as the decision of the American people to constitutionalize church-state separation. And in so doing, he supplied what is for many the authoritative interpretation of the religion clauses. Indeed, it's been suggested that, quote, no metaphor in American letters has had a greater influence on law and policy than Thomas Jefferson's wall of separation. But the fact that we're familiar with these words doesn't mean we agree about their meaning. And the idea remains controversial. What about the assertion a few years ago by a candidate for office that the separation of church and state is a lie that's been told to keep religious believers out of politics? This view is common in some circles, but I think it's mistaken. True, the wall of separation does not appear in the Constitution's text, but the idea of separation, properly understood, is connected in important ways to religious freedom, and so it's important that we get this idea right. Now, I think that solid scholarship has made it clear that Thomas Jefferson's views on religion were a bit idiosyncratic, even in his day. He didn't speak for everybody. And it probably was a mistake when the Supreme Court constitutionalized, back in 1947, this metaphor of Jefferson's about a wall of separation. As Justice Rehnquist once remarked, it's impossible to build sound constitutional doctrine on a figure of speech. Still, the distinction between the separation of religious and political authority is, I believe, crucial to America's healthy secularism. And it's also important to religious freedom generally. Indeed, as the Pope Emeritus once remarked, separation properly understood is a Christian legacy. Fundamental to Christianity is the distinction between what belongs to Caesar and what belongs to God. So don't take it from me, this guy was the Pope. The institutional and jurisdictional separation of religious and political authority then is a separationist feature that has helped religious freedom, I think, to thrive in America. Properly understood, separation is not a devious invention of the ACLU, but is a safeguard against governments who are tempted to assume the power to direct religious life. Separation of church and state doesn't mandate a thoroughly secular civil society from which religion has been scrubbed away. Separation doesn't require that we rule out religious exemptions or that governments ignore the burdens that laws can place on religious believers. It's true that sometimes people have asserted as much, but when they do, in John Courtney Murray's words, they stand the First Amendment on its head, and in that position, it can only gurgle nonsense. Our Constitution separates church and state not to confine religious belief, but to curb the ambitions and the reach of governments. Again, all this is a bit abstract, I know, and we should ask, what does it mean for that long list of current day controversies that I mentioned at the outset of this talk? How does church-state separation properly understood, or healthy secularity properly understood, how do those ideas translate into real-world disputes and present-day problems? So what should we think about a national day of prayer, or a war cross, a war memorial cross on Mount Soledad, or a Ten Commandments display in a courtyard? Right? What should we think about the HHS mandate or school vouchers and so on? Well, in the best tradition of a law professor, I'll raise those questions and then ignore them and move on. I said earlier that I think we should think about religious freedom not only as freedom from, and not only as freedom of, but primarily as freedom for religion. And I want to wrap things up by telling you a bit more about what I mean by those distinctions. So freedom from religion accepts religion as a social reality, but regards it as somewhat of a danger to the common good. Regards it as a practice that might have to be tolerated, but that should be confined. On this view, it's bad taste to bring religion into public life. So consistent with this approach, religious belief would probably be protected, but the permissible implications of that belief will be limited. The concern on a freedom from religion model is primarily with the domestication, or maybe the house training, the house breaking of religion. On this view, religious freedom is primarily not just, it's not only the right to choose not to belong to a religion, it's the right not to be affected or offended by other people's religious choices as well. So on this view, the role of law and government is to maintain strictly a boundary between private and public and to keep religion on the private side of the line. Now, this view has found some expression in American law and policy, but not too much. And in my view, that's a good thing. That's something for religious believers to celebrate. As I see it, the freedom from approach is not true to the Constitution. It's not true to religious liberty properly understood. And again, thankfully, its influence is primarily pronounced among academics rather than among real people. The second approach, freedom of religion, emphasizes toleration, neutrality, equal treatment. On this view, religion is something that matters to many people, and so the law should not single it out for special discrimination or hostility. Equality is the fundamental norm, equal treatment. On this view, the law recognizes and accepts that religious believers exist and institutions are at work in our society, and the law treats them even-handedly. In a sense, this position is religion blind. It's not hostile to religion, but it is nervous about treating religion as something special. On this view, religious liberty is just one subset of liberty, and we all have an equal right to liberty. So religion is not something to be singled out, either for accommodation or for discrimination. Religion is a matter of taste. It's not scary, but it's not special either. This model represents an improvement on the freedom from model, it seems to me. And it's also been reflected in American law, more so than the previous one. So the justices have emphasized, for example, that officials are not supposed to treat religiously motivated speech different than speech that reflects other viewpoints, as they should. But there's a third approach. This is freedom for religion. This way of thinking about the matter, in my view, represents the American experiment at its best. According to this approach, the search for religious truth is acknowledged as an important human activity. It's willing to say that religion is special, so special that the government ought not to interfere with it or direct it. Its exercise is seen as valuable, worthy of accommodation, even worthy of support. The idea is not that public authority should demand religious observances or tell us what should be orthodox or require religious activities. Far from it. The idea here is that a political community that is committed to positive secularity can still take note of the fact that a whole lot of people in the community long for the transcendent and are searching for the truth. And so even an appropriately secular limited state won't prescribe the path this search should take, but it will take steps, positive steps, to make sure that the freedom for religion and the conditions necessary for the exercise of religious freedom are nurtured. So on this approach, it's not enough simply to refrain from discriminating against religion. The government on this view will take special care to accommodate it, to facilitate it, always in a way that protects and respects the distinction between church and state. On this view, the government not only avoids imposing burdens on religion, it looks for ways to lift those burdens to the extent it can where they exist. And so, to return to the example with which I started, the current controversy about this so-called HHS mandate. Reasonable people can disagree, obviously, about the underlying policy. But it seems to me that it would be consistent with, and in fact it would honor, our Constitution and our traditions for the administration, or if necessary, a court, to exempt religious employers and institutions, like Notre Dame, from this mandate. To do this would not be, as some have suggested, to impose religious teachings on those who do not embrace them. It would be instead to accommodate these institutions' efforts to be distinctive and different and interesting and to act with integrity. To be sure, religious liberty is not absolute. Not all requests for exemptions and accommodations can be granted. Not all requests for exemptions and accommodations should be granted. In a pluralistic society, people will often disagree. And at the end of the day, the majority, in most cases, is entitled to pursue its understanding of the common good and to promote its conception of public order. But in such a society like ours, if we can accommodate religious objectors, if we can clear out space for freedom for religion, then I think we should. Now, admittedly, as many commentators and scholars and judges have complained, American law dealing with religious liberty is not entirely coherent. This is, in my view, precisely because of the tensions between and among these three ways of thinking about the matter. But, to wind up on a happy note, things could be worse. And in my view, they have improved in many respects, even as these new challenges arise. Our religious freedom protections here in the United States, as I said before, are robust but incomplete. And once again, the American experiment in religious freedom is both vital and vulnerable. Thank you. So I'm told we have time for questions. You guys have time for more pizza. I have a nice list of students from Professor Zitlow I'm supposed to call on you. So if you want to spare your fellow students from getting cold called, I'd welcome questions and comments, especially from the students to begin. And if not from students, then you know we professors can talk to each other. Any questions?
Could you say a little bit more about the health and human services discussion going on right now?
Sure. So just to be clear, I'm not representing any clients. I'm not speaking for the university. They have their own lawyers who are probably much more accomplished lawyers than I am. As you might know, there was an initial proposal to impose this mandate of coverage that was quite sweeping. And in recent months, the administration has indicated a willingness to expand some of the accommodation for religious institutions like Notre Dame, like Catholic Charities, and so on. It's difficult to speak with too much confidence on what's going to happen because the regulations are in flux. I mean, there's lawsuits going on one track, and there are administrative procedures going on another, and we are in kind of a wait-and-see mode. But my view, for what it's worth, is that the arguments against the mandate that are being made under the Federal Religious Freedom Restoration Act, I think those arguments are pretty strong. What that federal law says, simplified a bit, is that if you've got a federal policy that imposes a substantial burden on religious exercise, then the burden shifts to the government to show that, that's necessary in order to achieve a compelling government interest. And as I see it, we can assume for the sake of argument that the government's pursuing an important interest here, at least it's pursuing an important interest as it understands it. I think we should also take as given that the mandate does impose a burden on the religious exercise of many religious institutions. And so the question then becomes, is this burden necessary or is it avoidable? And given that the Affordable Care Act already has a great many exemptions and accommodations built into it, and given that it would be quite feasible to provide the services in question to employees at institutions that object, and there won't be very many of them, by other means, it seems to me that that's the direction that the Religious Freedom Restoration Act points in. Now, so far, the litigation is kind of inconclusive. Some cases have been kicked out on the theory that the dispute's not ripe yet. But there's a number of cases where courts have said, have enjoined the mandate, so pending trial and so on the theory that it appears that it does violate the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. Now, again, it could be that the administration will change the rules to such an extent that this dispute goes away. And my own view is that it's always a happy thing for everybody if disputes can be settled in that way rather than through litigation, but we'll see. Yes, ma'am.
Could that position include any splinter church group, any religious cult who has specific religious beliefs against any type of medical intervention? So that if you don't give contraception, maybe you don't give blood, maybe you don't give treatment.
So in my view, no, right? In my view, the whole question of religious accommodation is almost always kind of a contextual and case-by-case issue. So on the one hand, the political community has a right to try to, you know, pursue the common good and protect its people as it sees fit. I've suggested, and I think federal law reflects this idea, that to the extent the government can, it should accommodate religion. There's going to be some instances in which that accommodation is not possible. A lot of people believe, I think I incline toward this view, that when it comes to things like people who for religious reasons don't want to provide basic medical care to their children, they're going to lose. And again, I say that not meaning to disrespect those who have this belief, but in a pluralistic society, sometimes, you know, you got winners and losers. I think my position is actually pretty modest. It's that in a community like ours that's committed to religious freedom, that assumes difference and disagreement and regards it as a strength, not as something to be overcome. In a society like that, if you can accommodate religious objectors, you do. And I think the HHS mandate situation is a situation where you can, without undermining the government's policy, still accommodate. In cases about vaccinations or perhaps blood transfusions and so on, I think those are harder cases.
So is it just one particular issue, and is it basically is the main force Catholicism, or is it other splinter groups, religious groups, or is the biggest religious group might be all Catholicism, and is it over specific issues of that mandate, or I guess I want to say, I think accommodation wouldn't be already proposed in the church building. And my church, I mean the Catholic Church, have still rejected it. And what about the Catholic Church's position and then teaching of whether this used to work with Caesar and Paul's idea of being obedient to civil authority?
Yeah, so you're certainly right that a number of the plaintiffs in these cases are Catholic institutions, but not all of them, right? And in a number of these lawsuits...
Are the majority Catholics?
I think it's probably true that the majority are, yeah. I guess I'm not sure why that's thought to weaken the arguments, but so let's take as given that...
Because I think they have the strongest issue on one of the main things that they want to contest.
Sure, and I guess as I see it... It's always going to be the case in religious freedom litigation that the people who are bringing a challenge to a particular policy are going to be the ones whose religious beliefs are burdened by that policy. An institution that has no objections to providing this kind of coverage isn't going to bring a lawsuit because their religious freedom is not being burdened. In another case, you might find, and if you look back through the history of religious freedom litigation, I think we do find, that the plaintiffs might be predominantly, say, members of the Seventh-day Adventists or the Jehovah's Witnesses. I don't think the religious freedom... the merits of a religious freedom argument should depend very much on who the claimant is, right? The question is, does this claimant have a sincere religious objection to a particular policy, and is that an objection that we can accommodate? Again, sometimes we won't be able to accommodate such objections. This seems like an instance where we could. This is not the only instance. I mean, you could go back into the early 70s and you had a lot of litigation surrounding requested exemptions from the draft. And some of these cases were brought by members of the Peace Church. Some of these were brought by Roman Catholics who were invoking the just war tradition. Some were brought by conscientious objectors who weren't religious at all, but who said, my objections are just as deep as a religious objection. In the current context, it's true, as you point out, that because the dispute involves these preventive services to which it's primarily Catholics who object and many others who don't, that you're going to see a lot of plaintiffs who are Catholic. But I guess that shouldn't surprise us, and that shouldn't bother us very much, that the claimants all happen to be of one denomination.
Well, because there's a powerful denomination, and maybe the whole subject matter is only there because of the power.
That's possible. Yes, sir.
Any comments on the personhood issue in North Dakota? Seems to me on the face of it that it's very religious-based.
Yeah, I guess I probably wouldn't concede that the desire to identify very early unborn children as persons is necessarily religious-based. I mean, if in the law something depends on whether or not a particular entity is a person, we have to give an answer to that question. We do that in our civil criminal laws all the time. I do suspect that under current law, that effort will be invalidated by a federal court just because it's going to seem to be in tension with some of the Supreme Court's precedents. But there's all kinds of reasons why one might think, without referring to the Bible or to revealed religion at all, that the best place to draw the line where personhood starts is at conception rather than birth. We have to draw a line for purposes of our law somewhere. And it's not clear to me that one place to draw the line is any more religious than the other. It's true that these efforts are being supported strongly by people who are religious believers. But again, I think as I tried to suggest, maybe not very well, in response to the previous question, The fact that an argument is being advanced by a religious believer, in my view, doesn't count against that argument. Yes, sir.
As you said, that we uphold a society that is a protection for religion, doesn't that necessarily insinuate we should also have a protection for non-religion? And if that's true, don't those ideas kind of compete with each other, that we should uphold religious pursuit as something that's valuable to society, then shouldn't we uphold non-pursuits and actual attempts to dissuade religion?
Well, the way I tried to frame it, I mean, I think I agree with your point, but the way I would phrase it as the freedom of religion, the freedom of religious conscience, has to mean that the individual has the right to search or not for religious truth. Right? So the freedom of religious conscience has to include the right to reject religion. Right? So I think you and I would agree that even on my kind of freedom for religion model, it would never be the case that what government should do is try to take steps on its own to make everybody religious or to help the religion side win. That would be contrary to religious freedom, in my view. But it would take steps to the extent it can to allow religious freedom to flourish, right? So just to take an example, it would be a lot harder in the United States for religion and religious freedom to flourish if every church had to pay the same income tax as another corporation. So we, you know, for a long time, we've exempted churches and religious institutions from some tax. There's been times in our history when that's controversial. It does seem like a special treatment for religion. You know, lots of entities would like to be tax exempt, and not everyone can be, right? So is that special treatment for religion? It is. But I think it's justifiable special treatment given our traditions. What would be unjustifiable, I think we agree, would be to say, because we have these traditions of respecting religious liberty, that we therefore have the government get in the business of helping people along to finding the religious truth. It's not the government's business to declare or identify what the religious truth is, but I think it is permissible for the government to take steps to make it possible for us to search after that. Yes, sir.
All right, so with this protection for, are you saying that it would actually be good in something like an institution to actually have the government create an affirmative accommodation when it's the institution trying to make a decision for an employee or trying to make a decision?
Tell me one more time in mind. What kind of institution?
Well, let's say HHS. Yeah. So an employer doesn't want to pay,
right,
or doesn't want their insurance plan to cover something for employees, but have different gifts.
Right.
So you're saying the government should actually create an affirmative exemption from secular law to protect this view which they're trying to enforce on.
Yeah. Well, I'm not probably not agreeing with your premise, but I'm agreeing with your conclusion. So if we take, let's say, a parochial school's, you know, imaginary St. Cecilia's, that is trying to be an authentic Catholic institution, and it thinks that it's inconsistent with that to be providing a certain coverage, then yeah, I think in order to allow this institution to be consistent with its mission, the government should exempt them from the mandate. I don't regard that as imposing views on anybody, because I would certainly object if there was a law telling people that they couldn't use these services on their own. This is not a question about whether these employees can use the services in question. It's about who's going to pay for them. And if the government wants to pay for them, that's fine.
Well, so that is the question. And my answer to it is that in a country like ours that values religious freedom and that long has, when you can accommodate religious freedom, you should. The presumption
is that accommodating religious freedom, even when the beliefs in question are unpopular, if you can do it without causing grave harm to third parties and so on, then you do. So, you know, is it a special treatment? Is it an accommodation? Yes, it is. In my view, it's a justifiable one. Well, your last part, I'm afraid, I just don't think that's an accurate characterization of what's going on. Yeah.
In 2009, Pope Benedict changed the position of the church in terms of allowing condoms to be used in Africa by the population in response to the AIDS epidemic, which had already killed untold millions of people as a result of the denial of reproductive health care. Should we move in any small increment in that direction in the United States by denying women access to birth control when we are creating federal policies, healthcare policies, which include that type of issue, or don't include that kind of position because people are standing up and saying it's against my religious beliefs?
Sir, with all due respect, nothing I've said would even point in the direction of saying that the government should start denying access to these or any other preventive services to people who want them. This is a question about whether Catholic institutions should be required to pay for them for their employees.
I thought they were already exempted from that. I thought they were already given accommodation.
Some are and some aren't.
Am I getting the hook, Dean?
One more question.
All right. Yes, ma'am.
You talked about burdening religion and burdening religious institutions, but you didn't really discuss the burden on the individual religious practitioner. And it occurs to me, for example, as a Catholic, I'm very aware that the vast majority of practicing Catholics practice contraception, that while the institution of Catholicism may have doctrine against that, actual practitioners do not necessarily adopt that. And so there is a tension between the institutional, the large, and the individual on the other end. And so you're talking about burden. What about the burden on the individual as opposed to the institution?
Well, I certainly agree with you that religious freedom laws and constitutional provisions protect individuals every bit as much and primarily as they do institutions. So if the government, there are sole proprietors who are bringing some of these lawsuits in question too, who don't want to have to provide it. Now, I think what you might be getting at is that it could be that an employee, a Catholic employee of Notre Dame, doesn't have any problem with contraception, and they're perfectly willing to use it. And that's obviously true. And I think it would be a really bad idea if any Catholic institution, including Notre Dame, were to try to tell employees what they could and couldn't do in private. But I'm just going to keep insisting, but it sounds like I'm not persuading you, that this is a different question, right? And on the question of what people actually do, I try to be a Christian, I guess, but I'm pretty confident that most of us who try to be Christians fail to live up all the time to the injunction, turn your cheek and love your neighbor and all that. And so the fact that a lot of people don't live up or don't even believe what's taught authoritatively by their churches doesn't mean that those churches lose the right to teach and believe it.
Thank you very much, Professor Garnett, and please join me in thanking him for the stimulating talk.